Hello, welcome to The Daily Politics. It's the day after the day after the autumn statement. Stay with me. But the government's still being criticised over forecasts suggesting a big squeeze on living standards. But have the economic forecasters taken too gloomy a view of what might happen post-Brexit? And do they have a record of getting it right or wrong? We'll talk to the head of the Office for Budget Responsibility. MEPs have voted to freeze EU membership talks with Turkey. That's not pleased Turkey's president, who says if it happens, he'll open the gates for migrants to enter Europe. It's the first ever conference of the Women's Equality Party, and they say membership is growing fast. But can it win many votes in a crowded political marketplace? Tony Blair's coming back. No, we really mean it this time. He says he's going to find a home for millions of the politically homeless and could campaign for Brexit to be reversed. All that in the next hour, and with us for the first half of the programme today, a journalist so knowledgeable about all things political, he thinks Black Friday refers to a stock market crash rather than early Christmas sales. I'm sure that's very unfair. It's the political editor of The Sun, Tom Newton Dunn. Welcome to the programme.
Hello.
First of all today, let's talk about a bill being debated by MPs today that, if passed, will make it an offence for people to wear military medals they're not entitled to. Those found guilty will face a maximum penalty of 6 months imprisonment or a £5,000 fine. Well, normally a private member's bill brought forward by an individual MP would stand little chance of getting onto the statute books. But you might remember that when we covered this story earlier in the week, we spoke to the Armed Forces Minister, who confirmed that the government will be throwing its weight behind the plan. Let's take a look.
The hurt of someone being as deceitful as wearing a gallantry medal. It's not just like a Northern Ireland medal that I want. I mean, I'm no hero at all. I serve in the armed forces. These are different people we're talking about. These are the people that have gone beyond the call of duty, got a gallantry medal, and then someone is impersonating them. That's really difficult. It will have the fallbacking of the government. I will sit on committee when it goes through the committee to make sure that the government's view is there.
That's the Minister, Mike Penning. Tom Newton Dunn, how big a problem is this?
I think we've seen medal fraud, as it's called, for a while. I used to be a defence correspondent before I got dragged down to these paths. and I have to say, we used to get quite a lot of good copy out of hunting down and being able to expose these quite appalling fruitcakes who turn up at these medal parades, normally with a droopy moustache and an SAS beret, pretending they'd done all sorts of things. But what has increased is the amount of gantry medals that people now have because Iraq and Afghanistan, a whole lot of people did a whole lot of incredible things. So I think the impersonation is probably trying to keep up to pace with the level of medals people got. And it really is incredibly offensive if you've been through all this. And I think it should be, and now I'm very pleased to see the government is now looking at it as a type of fraud.
Right. I mean, that is one thing, but you used the word fruitcakes. I mean, isn't the risk of actually having a prison sentence or a very large fine, is that really disproportionately harsh on people who may have a mental health problem, for example, or even though it's offensive, would people want to see others go to jail?
I think if you have mental health problems and you are clearly quite a disturbed individual, the courts are never going to send you to prison because they never do anyway. But for me, it strikes me as quite a useful thing to have there as a penalty, as a background, a hard drop, to simply stop this type of fraud being permitted. I mean, it really is conning people into giving you some respect, treatment, sometimes even money if you're fundraising for a charity, when you say you've done something you clearly haven't done.
All right, let's leave it there. We'll keep track of it. Now, it's time for our daily quiz. And there's been a lot of talk this week about Donald Trump's suggestion that Nigel Farage should be made the UK's next ambassador to the US. Amazing what one tweet can do. But one Labour MP has come up with a novel suggestion for who should be the next US ambassador to Britain. John Mann has tabled an early day motion in Parliament to ask fellow MPs to back the idea. So who does he think should be America's man or woman in London? Is it A, Clint Eastwood? B, Kim Kardashian. C, Bruce Springsteen. Or D, Sarah Palin. And a little later on, Tom will give us the correct answer. I'm sure. Now, it may be Black Friday at the shops today, thanks to an imported American marketing gimmick, but is it also a bit of a black day for the economic prospects of British workers? That was the view of several think tanks and forecasters who yesterday gave us their now traditional post-match analysis of Chancellor Philip Hammond's autumn statement, and they were pretty gloomy about what it all meant. The Institute for Fiscal Studies described the outlook for wages as dreadful. It said that workers will, in real terms, earn less in 2021 than they did in 2008. That's the worst decade for living standards, probably since the 1920s, according to the IFS. Downing Street didn't like that, saying that living standards are at their highest level ever. The Prime Minister's spokeswoman said that real household disposable income is the best way to measure living standards and that it's rising under this government. The impact that Brexit will have on the economy has been a bone of contention since the Independent Office for Budget Responsibility published its forecast alongside the autumn statement on Wednesday. It said the government will have to borrow an extra £58.7 billion over the next 5 years because of Brexit. The OBR has come under fire from Brexit-supporting Conservative MPs. Jacob Rees-Mogg said the forecasts were based on lunatic assumptions about future trade tariffs. And the former Cabinet Minister Ian Duncan-Smith said the OBR was very close to the Treasury and pretty much wrong on everything. And this morning, leading Leave campaigners, including Michael Gove and Gisela Stewart, have said that the OBR's figures also reveal a Brexit dividend of over £10 billion a year. That's the money we'll no longer send to the EU after we've left. They say that the money should be spent on the NHS. Well, joining me now is the chairman of the Office for Budget Responsibility, Robert Choate. Welcome to the Daily Politics. Before we look at the forecast you produced this week, let's look back to the forecast during the referendum campaign, because many people would say they all turned out to be wrong, because a lot of the economic institutions, the Treasury, the Bank of England, the IMF, etc., said that a Brexit vote would cause an immediate downturn. And that hasn't happened.
No, it isn't. And obviously, we weren't one of the organisations that produced a forecast ahead of the referendum trying to guess what would happen if it did. I think, as you say, some people thought that the impact of greater uncertainty would have a much more dramatic and instantaneous approach, but that then, as it were, the picture would get clearer in terms of the policy, the outcome of the negotiations as things went on. I think the instant reaction has been less painful in terms of the economy, but people are nonetheless not as much the wiser in terms of what the government's objectives are in the negotiations and what the likely outcome is going to be. So that's going to take some time, I think, still to clear up.
Right, and there's been a wave of criticism following your forecast, and you used the word guessing, and as you say, many of those forecasts during the campaign were wrong. And so although you have caveated your forecast by saying you didn't have that much information to go on, how seriously should we take them?
Well, I think, as I say, they are our best estimate of what would happen on what we've managed to interpret as current government policy. We asked explicitly in the run-up to the autumn statements the government whether they wanted to tell us, and implicitly obviously everybody else, anything more about their aims or expectations for the negotiations than was already in the public domain, and they said they didn't want to do that. So we've had to make some broad brush assumptions, for example, that you would end up with imports and exports growing less quickly than would otherwise be the case, that net inward migration would be lower. So we've had to do it on that sort of basis, and we then need to wait and see when there's more information about both the result of the negotiations and what the government's trying to get out of it to refine that. But I don't think we're going to be much the wiser very quickly, so I wouldn't hold your breath on that.
I mean, David Cameron at the time said a Leave vote would put a bomb under the British economy. But interestingly, looking at your growth forecasts, you do see growth continuing. There is a dip, 2017, 2018, but then it picks up again. So in a way, even those forecasts don't see a great downturn.
Well, we're somewhat to the more optimistic end of the spectrum. We're more optimistic than the Bank of England and the average of outside forecasters. There are two main things that are driving the sort of weakening that most people expect into next year, one of which is that uncertainty about where we'll end up on things like trade and migration will weaken business investment. And the other thing is that we've already seen a sharp fall in the pound, which will push up import prices and mean that the pound in a consumer's pocket will go less far. So it's those two things carrying on that leads to the weakness next year.
And isn't this just playing politics by the Leave campaigners? They just don't want to hear this kind of information or forecast because obviously undermines their whole campaign and the drive to leave the EU.
I think actually also you'd find a few Remainers playing politics with this as well. For example,
surprise,
Robert has just said, strange enough, politicians play politics.
Yes.
But Robert, as the IFS, agreed with Robert's analogy of his own slightly more positive end of the scale in terms of his Brexit prognosis yesterday. Some of the Remainers are saying, well, how on earth has Robert and his merry men managed. Got to trend growth, you know, 2.5% by 2019 when we're supposed to be leaving the EU? So my personal view, Robert was dealt a hospital pass by this. He's supposed to forecast something which no one has the faintest clue how it could possibly work out. And by his own admission, he gave his own forecast only, what, a 50% chance of even coming true? So he's beaten up a bit too hard, methinks.
Right. Do you think you're being caught in the middle here? Because there's been a lot of criticism. I don't know how wounded you are by this. I'm sure you're, you know, tough when this sort of stuff is thrown at you. But they are accusing you of being too close to the Treasury, leading Leave campaigners, and pretty much wrong on everything. Do you think in the end you're going to be the one that is caught between the two sides?
Well, I think all we have to, I mean, you have to recognise that this is, we've seen this for months, an extremely heated debate and hotly contested, and it's not surprising that, tempers and emotions are running high. All we can do under those circumstances is to set out the assumptions that we've made as transparently as we can. So, if you take a more or less optimistic view of where the negotiations are going to end up, if you think the government is going to exploit or not exploit the opportunities to move policy in a more growth-friendly direction, you can take the numbers that we've started with and aim off in one direction or the other. So hopefully it's still a useful exercise, even if people don't buy the central conclusion we've reached.
Well, let's look at two specifics. One on trade, because Conservative MP Jacob Rees-Mogg has said that you've assumed after we leave the EU, we'll apply the same tariffs to the rest of the world that we currently apply. His point being that, of course, those tariffs, you know, may not be there. That's the whole point of leaving the EU. We'll have free trade deals. Do you think that was a mistake?
No, I think the consensus of the people who are experts in the way in which trade is modelled and those sorts of assumptions, if you look at the studies, the middle of the pack, not the most optimistic or least pessimistic, there was a general consensus that you would see imports and exports growing less quickly over a 5 to 10 year period than you would otherwise do, partly as you have to get to the new set of trade arrangements, but then, you know, will trade be more difficult within the EU, even if it's easier somewhere else? And so I think you're right in saying that if, you know, people like Jacob Rees-Mogg, Patrick Minford, who I think you were talking to recently,
yesterday, yes,
would favour a much more liberal trade regime. Whether in the sort of global context that's the direction in which trade policy will go, it's not just our decision, it's other countries too, remains to be seen.
And that's the problem, isn't it? Because there are still so many shades of views concerning how Brexit will actually be done. And that makes it even more difficult to predict what will happen.
There is no agreement at all on what Brexit should look like. And indeed, the government, we still don't think, has their own plan yet. They're still doing all their thoughting and their modelling. It does beg one question, though, Robert, which is a point that's been made by several, is if there is no conclusive path for all this at all, why do you not model several different outcomes, perhaps a soft Brexit outcome and a hard Brexit outcome? Because all Philip Hannity, he's taken your numbers and he's borrowed £122 billion extra off the back of something which you only say is 50% likely.
Yeah, so I think given the uncertainties that we have around the sort of relatively broad brush forecast that we've done at the moment and, you know, people's very justifiable realisation of how much you should place in any forecast, if we were coming up with precisely calibrated differences between what difference it would make if it was WTO or Canada Plus or Canada Minus or Norway models, I'm not sure. I think that the differences between each of those scenarios would be dwarfed by the uncertainty around any one of them. And therefore, the best thing for us to do is to basically take some broad assumptions consistent with the bulk of external analysis. And then we have to wait until the fog clears in order to come up with something that's more specifically tied to a particular outcome.
All right, Robert Choate, thank you very much. Now, there was much talk in the run-up to the autumn statement about what the Chancellor might do for low-income families, the just about managing. He took limited action in one controversial area by softening cuts to universal credit, the new umbrella benefit gradually being introduced across the UK. He offered claimants partial respite by changing the so-called taper rate. The Resolution Foundation said this would save claimants up to £300, but previous cuts may have cost them more than £2,000. So what do Conservative MPs who've campaigned successfully last year against previous proposed cuts to tax credits? Well, we're joined by one of them now. Johnny Mercer is in our Plymouth studio. Johnny Mercer, welcome to the programme. The government says it's tried to offset the cuts to universal credit. Have they done enough?
I think they've made a pretty strong step in the right direction. You know, would I have liked more? Clearly, yes, I would have done. But, you know, the Chancellor made it really clear that he'd thought about the evidence, he'd listened to everybody. We'd made a step in that direction. He's done what he can. And so I welcome that. Would I have liked him to have done more? Obviously, I would have done. But look, he's got a huge budget to balance, and I think he's done a pretty good job.
But if you remember the rhetoric by Theresa May on the doorstep number 10, where she said she wanted to help those people who are just about managing, even though he has put a certain amount of money in to mitigate the cuts to universal credit, they in no way reverse them, and so those families are still going to be worse off.
Yeah, if this is taken in isolation, you're absolutely right.
But not even in isolation, Johnny Mercer, even if you take it in the round. I mean, the government and the Treasury put out a statement to say that you've got to look at higher living wage, money for childcare, freezing fuel duty. They'll still be worse off, some of those families.
Some of those families, I believe, in particular percentiles will still struggle on these benefits. And that's why I say that it's, you know, as far as I'm concerned, I would like it to go further. But I do think it's slightly disingenuous to then say that we're not looking after the just about managings or doing what we can for the lowest, you know, the sort of bottom 20% of society that people like me are involved in politics for. I actually think, you know, if you look in somewhere like Plymouth, you know, we keep talking about it, but the single biggest driver in improving life chances for our most vulnerable is having a job, and that unemployment's halved since 2010. Is there more we can do? Of course there is. There always is. But I welcome this on Thursday, and, you know, the fight goes on.
The fight goes on. What are you doing in terms of the fight then? Because it sounds like you would like George Osborne's cuts to work allowances to be abandoned and ditched altogether, because then people can earn more before they actually lose their benefits. Is that what you would like to see?
What I would like to see is for the income tax threshold to continue to go up as it is, for people to keep more of the money they earn. And that is the direction of travel we're taking. We're also balancing that against a very difficult fiscal position, against going through a transition, if you like, from a high welfare state to making people less dependent on state welfare. And in places like Plymouth, that is transforming cities like Plymouth. So I believe we are marching in that direction. Could we do more? Could we go quicker? I'd always like to think so, but we have a huge budget to balance for, and we're in pretty tricky times with Brexit and all that.
Well,
and,
but Philip Hammond has said,
and Philip's clearly working towards that as well.
Yes, although of course he has loosened the target for actually balancing the books, so he has a little bit more room for manoeuvre in those terms. But you mentioned, the fight goes on. What are you doing? Are you lobbying the Chancellor then to try and go further in the next year or so on this?
We just need to make sure that as a team of Conservative MPs, we follow through on the promise to look after the most vulnerable in society. And that's across the pitch, whether it's to do with universal credit or it's to do with halving the disability gap, for example, which is something we're working on at the moment. And there's a report coming out from the CSJ in January about this. We are doing a good job on this, but we're not going as far as we said we would in the manifesto. So when I say the fight goes on, most Conservative MPs believe that we judge ourselves by how we look after the most vulnerable in society, and the fight goes on to make sure that our policies work for them.
All right, but the criticism was pretty damaging, the assessment from the Resolution Foundation, once they'd crunched the numbers, and the Institute of Fiscal Studies. No wonder Downing Street will be unhappy about it, because they haven't lived up to the rhetoric.
Not at all. I think Downing Street would probably be quite cross that somehow the narrative going into this autumn statement was it's going to be all about helping the just about managing. The Institute of Fiscal Studies said something quite interesting yesterday, which slightly got lost amid the whole terrible headlines of a lost decade of wage growth, which was Philip Hammond Hammond has clearly prioritised what money he had to spend on capital investment, fiscal stimulus for the economy, road building, etc., as opposed to helping the just about managing. Now, I think Johnny's being a little bit polite here. What he would really like to say, if I'm not trying to put too many words in his mouth, is I'm sick to the back teeth that the government I really want to support put only 700 million of the universal credit cuts back into what should have been 3.4 billion. That's barely a fifth of the reversal of the cuts.
Is that what you think, Johnny Mercer?
I could slightly come back on that. Yes. What I would say is what Tom indicates there around infrastructure, that is all towards growth. That is all towards closing the productivity gap, which is all towards raising higher standards. So I don't think these things are actually contrary to each other. There are many ways of having this fight against poverty. One is to improve the infrastructure. If you look at Plymouth, the rail line is integral to getting jobs for opportunities for young people in Plymouth.
All right.
And that is infrastructure. So I see what Tom's saying, but as much as I always agree with Tom, on this occasion, I may decline.
Well, you don't always agree then. All right, Johnny Mercer, thank you. Is Tony Blair planning on making a comeback? Well, it's been written about more times than Tom's had hot dinners, but this time it seems like it really might be happening. Yes, you heard it right. The former Labour Prime Minister, winner of three general elections, has announced he's returning to politics, sort of. But this time, Mr. Blair, who isn't exactly universally popular these days, says he wants to build a platform for the political centre ground. In an interview in the New Statesman, Mr. Blair explained he wanted to provide a service to political leaders in the form of a technology-inspired platform. He said, "I think in Britain today you've got millions of effectively politically homeless people. I think the absolute essence is to revive the centre. What I'm doing is to spend more time not in the front line of politics. There are elements of the media who would literally move to destroy mode if I tried to do that. But in trying to create the space for a political debate about where modern Western democracies go and where the progressive forces particularly find their place." Well, we're joined now by Matthew Doyle, who used to work for Tony Blair at Number 10, and by the UKIP MEP, Tim Aker. Welcome to the programme. Yeah. Explain exactly what Tony Blair wants to do.
Well, I find it fascinating that nearly 20 years after Tony was first elected as Prime Minister, there are still so many sort of column inches dedicated to what he's doing, what he's saying, what he's thinking.
Not favourable, a lot of them, of course.
And I think there's also something sort of depressing about it, frankly, in terms of it speaks to a bigger problem that there is in politics at the moment for the centre ground, which is the problem that he has, in a sense, identified, and why I think it's right that he uses the platform that he does get through being a former Prime Minister to express a view on this. Look, the 48% in the referendum lost, but that doesn't mean that the 48% should be denied a voice in the debate. And I think it's important that as we go forward with the discussions around Brexit, the debate about what that looks like and what it means is held in a way that does give the 48% a voice.
Does he want to reverse Brexit?
Look, he thinks it's a bad idea that we're leaving the European Union, no question about it. In terms of what ends up happening in terms of the decision, then my personal view is I think it's pretty clear we're on a track to leaving the European Union. The question is what the nature of that happens. Now, there are all sorts of promises that were made in the course of the referendum campaign that said, don't worry, it'll be fine. The Germans will still want to sell us the cars. The French will still want to sell us their cheese or whatever it was. If it turns out that there is a different scenario, then just as John Major is also saying in the papers today, I think it's right that the public gets a chance, if it decides it wants to, say, well, hang on a minute, this isn't what we were told at the time.
Are you pleased to see Tony Blair return to politics in some form?
Well, it's Christmas come early, hasn't it? I mean, Tony Blair's known for two things. Well, for my side of the argument, surely. He's known for Iraq and the mess that that caused. And also, it's the age of mass immigration, when
and
no immigration controls...
And winning three elections?
And winning three elections, but we didn't create immigration controls when the EU expanded. And for all of this talk of the centre ground and so on, just ignores the debate. There's the common ground. Things have moved on. But it's noticeable him talking about the forgotten in politics when... I remember the Welsh devolution referendum was much closer than the Brexit one. Where was he talking then about the forgotten people of Wales who didn't want the Welsh Assembly? So I think he's back to quell the Brexit revolt, and you'll find that more and more people will actually look at Tony Blair's record and see, wow, he's coming back, he's telling us what to do again, we're going to fight back against it. I think he's a drain on those people that want a single market or a soft Brexit.
I mean, do you think he will actually help the people, the 48%, the 16 million, many of whom would not only like to stay in the EU, but would certainly like to stay as a member of the single market?
Well, as I say, I do think it's a problem that we haven't got more voices that are vocally speaking on behalf of the 48%. I mean, frankly, I think it's a part of the problem that the Labour Party is in at the moment. And I think it would be good for the Labour Party to step up more and be more vocal in being clear.
Because he doesn't believe that Jeremy Corbyn is the right man to do it. But is he the right man to do it, Tony Blair?
Well, I would say that he is. I think he's got the experience of being Prime Minister. He's got the experience of previous European negotiations, just as I would argue it's good that we hear from John Major, as he's quoted in the Times today on talking in this debate. I think the government would be wise to listen to former Prime Ministers who've been part of these European negotiations and get a sense from them of where they should proceed, because they're certainly making a mess of it at the moment.
Right. I mean, what do you think in terms of Tony Blair trying to come back in and add his voice to perhaps Nick Clegg and Ed Miliband, the Remain side, the 48%. And do you think the government really wants any more help? It's had a suggestion of Nigel Farage to help in America, and now Tony Blair to come in on the Brexit negotiations.
Tony Blair for Washington DC ambassador. That would be a way of solving that problem. I think Tony Blair's motives are quite interesting. He clearly is a hugely passionate pro-European. He spent his entire premiership signing us up to all the great pro-EU causes. Probably would have been including the single currency if Gordon Brown and Balls didn't have their way. That's another arguable point. So clearly he has some belief by it. However, I do have to say this. I was in the press conference room after the Chilcot inquiry where Tony Blair was painfully aware of how his entire reputation was going straight down the plug hole because of that one report. And I just wonder whether he now thinks Brexit is something he can perhaps try and rehabilitate himself on, although Tim obviously wouldn't see it that way, but maybe he can try and reverse some of the damage with Chilcot and try and make this the flag he can be remembered.
Are you worried that actually big personality, a big figure like Tony Blair throwing his weight behind the discussion on Brexit could actually move towards a softer departure from the EU?
I don't think so. Because during the referendum, we had all the big establishment figures, former prime ministers, big opinion formers who said, no, Brexit would be a terrible thing, don't vote for it. This just reinforces the view that the establishment are now fighting back. They don't accept the result and they're doing everything they can. But on the point of the gentleman just mentioned about Corbyn, there was a poll, and I know we should not take much emphasis on polls given how wrong they've been.
No, they haven't had a good track record
but
recently.
On the approval ratings of Corbyn and Blair, only 1 point separated them two, and that was a Comrades poll in October, I believe. So, you know, if he thinks he's more popular than Corbyn, it's going to change the mood of the country, he's got another thing coming.
Well, of course, there have been some surprises this year, but anyway, thank you to both of you. Now, the Women's Equality Party was launched last year to campaign for gender equality for the benefit of all. So far, it stood candidates in London, Wales and Scotland without success. But it says it has gained 65,000 members and registered supporters. And this weekend is holding its first conference in Manchester. But with a female Prime Minister in number 10, does the public think there's room for a new party? We sent Ellie out with the mood box to find out.
Welcome to Maidenhead, the home of Theresa May, Britain's second ever female Prime Minister. Evidence, surely, of equality in the sexes in the upper echelons of politics. What we're asking today is, does there need to be a separate political party that deals with the issues and interests of women? Yes or no? Marvellous, thank you very much.
Isn't there one that does that?
There is, it's called the Women's Equality Party.
Oh, right, well, there you go.
You think that's a good idea?
Yeah.
Great, take a ball for me.
No, and the reason being is women, you shouldn't stigmatise one particular part of a community. So be it women, be it men, be it a race, be it a culture. So it's all part of one community, so therefore no.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
I think there should be more women involved in the politics. And constitutional rights of everybody for equality, and they should also be getting a fairer wage.
It's 2016, you're all about equality, so that is kind of a backward step.
Be divisive?
Yeah.
Should I put it in yes or no?
If you no, I said no, didn't I?
You did, yeah.
So I'll go with a no.
Lovely, thank you. I'll have one of your coffees. Well, sorry, I'm being a lady who lunches. About halfway would seem the no's just about have it.
Women have different views to like men, I suppose, so I don't know.
Good idea then to have their own party?
Have a what, sorry?
You think it's a good idea then to have a women's party?
Maybe.
Yeah.
No.
No. Okay.
I don't know, because it gives them a voice, doesn't it?
Yeah. Should there be a separate political party for women's interests?
No.
Because women can multitask. I think multitasking is the important thing, and they're more caring.
So a separate political party would be a good idea?
Yeah, it would be a good idea.
All right.
Yes.
Could you want one for the sheep?
One for the sheep, yeah, the sheep can have one.
You've asked me before.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I remember, actually. Go on, then.
Thank you.
Don't tell anyone I gave you two votes.
If you have a separate party for women, then you'd have to have a separate party for men.
No, because women and men shouldn't be separated from each other. They should be together.
It was close, and lots of people said that politics is still far too dominated by men. But on balance, the good people of Maidenhead say no, there needn't be a separate political party.
Great music. And the leader of the Women's Equality Party, Sophie Walker, joins me now from our studio in Salford. Welcome. So Theresa Hello. May has recently become our second female Prime Minister. We've got women running devolved administrations in Scotland and Northern Ireland. Do we really need a Women's Equality Party?
Well, the 1,500 people who are gathering in Manchester for this weekend would certainly agree with you, and so would the 65,000 members and registered supporters of this party. There is a very big difference between having a female leader and a female leader who leads with an understanding of women's needs and women's experiences and prioritises that. We have been working with the What Women Want survey over the last 2.5 months. We've been hearing very loud and clear from thousands and thousands of women who are still asking for equal pay and still asking for affordable childcare and still asking for fair pensions, why none of these things appear to be important enough for mainstream Westminster politics.
Right, Tom Newton Dunn, why are these issues, these key issues, still not being resolved?
I think Sophie put it very well there. There is a huge dichotomy between male and female workforces. Pay, especially coming back into work, if you've been out of it, if you've been away, caring, looking after a child. I suppose I can't really answer that question.
But we need a party then.
So there are 450 male MPs who care about other things like defence spending or certainly more sort of, you know, potentially old-fashioned male-dominated issues. There is absolutely a place, I think, in British politics for a female-orientated party to campaign for female issues, like there was one to give people a voice who wanted to leave the EU.
Right, except, of course, so far, in terms of representation, so you're not really making any ground. You came sixth in the London mayoral election, beating George Galloway. Did you expect to do better?
We got 250,000 votes in London for the London mayoral election about 10 months after we opened for membership. And we just narrowly missed out on getting an assembly seat. And we were really pleased with that result. And the impact that had is actually being seen today because Sadiq Khan, the London mayor, is today announcing the results of his gender pay audit at City Hall, which was our policy. We are the party that aims to get this done by all means.
Right.
And so actually to see the other parties take on our policies and start doing this too and see actually that they will lose votes if this doesn't become more of a priority.
Yes.
Is effective for
so
us too.
I mean, imitation is the highest form of flattery. So in that sense, does it matter if you don't have that much representation electorally, if you can pressurise existing groups and parties into taking on your policies?
Well, more representation of women in politics is incredibly important. And one of the things we really want to do by having this party be as effective as it is to say that to women, yeah, there is a space for you in politics, you can make your voices heard. And that is why we're so pleased that more than half of our membership tell us they've never been a member of a political party ever before. And they're coming to us because they're saying things like, finally, somebody sees me and understands me and can help me to participate in politics.
Right. And just briefly on Hillary Clinton, do you think all women really should have voted? They had a duty to vote for Hillary Clinton in the election.
I think success of Donald Trump is incredibly sad. It was a vote to say that misogyny doesn't matter, that racism doesn't matter, that sexism doesn't matter. And it was also the successful campaign of someone claiming to be anti-establishment, who is about as establishment as it gets. The idea that this person who lives in a gold-plated penthouse is representing the masses is ludicrous, frankly.
Okay.
But the fact that that is out there now means that actually our job in some ways is easier.
All right,
because
we
can stop discussing whether sexism actually exists.
All right, Sophie Walker, enjoy your conference. Now it's
Thank
time
you.
To find out the answer to our quiz, Tom Newton Dunn. And the question was, who does John Mann MP think should be the next US ambassador to Britain? Was it A, Clint Eastwood, B, Kim Kardashian, C, Bruce Springsteen, or D, Sarah Palin? What is the correct answer?
The correct answer is C, the boss, Bruce Springsteen himself.
All right, well, thank you very much and well done.
Thank you very much.
It's just gone 12:30. Coming up in a moment, it's our regular look at what's been going on in European politics. For now, though, it's time to say goodbye to my guest of the day, Tom Newton Dunn, and thank you very much for being with us. So, for the next half an hour, we're going to be focusing on Europe. We'll be talking about the vote by MEPs to freeze EU membership talks with Turkey, the reaction in Brussels to a visit by the Brexit secretary, and we've been to Latvia to find out how they view Russia. First, though, here's our guide to the latest from Europe in just 60 seconds.
In France, former PM François Fillon surprised winning the first round in the centre-right Republican Party's contest to pick a candidate for next year's presidential election. He'll face centrist Alain Juppé in a runoff this weekend. Former President Nicolas Sarkozy came a disappointing third. MEPs backed a common defence policy, a non-binding vote called for multinational forces and a joint HQ to manage crises. German Chancellor Angela Merkel said she'd run for a fourth term in office next year. One challenger might be Martin Schulz. The President of the European Parliament said he'd swap Brussels for German politics. UKIP faced multiple investigations after claims they misspent EU funds on their referendum campaign. And Brexit Secretary David Davis met with Guy Verhofstadt, the EU Parliament's chief negotiator. Had Mr Davis really called him Satan?
He was the Satan, not you.
That clarifies it all.
And with us for the next 30 minutes, I've been joined by the Conservative MEP Ashley Fox and the UKIP MEP Gerard Batten. Welcome to both of you. Let's take a look at one of those stories in more detail, and that's the visit by Brexit Secretary David Davis to meet with senior MPs. Ashley Fox, Manfred Weber said our government has no idea what Brexit means. Guy Verhofstadt, the European Parliament's chief Brexit negotiator, said that the process was going to be tough and very intense. David Davis said it had all been really rather fun and very useful. So, who's not quite being straight?
Well, Joe, this was a getting-to-know-you session, the first time that David Davis has been across to Brussels and Strasbourg to get to know the key players. This is about building relationships. The negotiations don't start until March, so I'm very happy with how things are going.
You are. I mean, in a way, we know what many of the leaders in the EU think, so nobody should be surprised by what they've said so far.
No, the government doesn't have a plan. It doesn't really want to leave anyway, in my view. And, of course, Mr Verhofstadt...
What makes you think that?
Mrs May was a Remainer. If Remain had won, she'd now be telling us it was the best decision and everything's going to be wonderful. I do have a plan, because I wrote one 2 years ago on how we get out. It's called The Road to Freedom. It's very simple and clear. And, of course, Mr Verhofstadt confirmed... to Mr Davis, that the four freedoms of the EU, including freedom of movement and open borders, are non-negotiable. So one of the key things that we want out of leaving the EU, which is to control borders and immigration, they've already told us we can't have.
All right.
So what kind of plan gets over that?
No one does. Right, well, you hold on to that for the moment. Let's welcome Jean Lambert, who is a Green MEP. Welcome to the Daily Politics. What do you think of the tone of that meeting between Guy Verhofstadt and David Davis, the Brexit secretary?
Well, I think when you're listening to the reports of it, you almost wonder sort of whether they were in the same meeting. But I think that, you know, it is true that my understanding is that at least their agreement is there needs to be a strong European Union going into the future. So that has implications, I think, for how the EU handles their side of the negotiations. But I think it's also very clear from what I've been hearing is that the UK still hasn't really got its head around the magnitude of what it is doing here and even some of the technicalities. It would appear that David Davis hadn't even realised that the European Parliament gets a vote on the Article 50 outcome. So, you know, there are some of these things there which you really think, you know, the government should have a handle on.
Right, that's fairly basic. Do you really think David Davis didn't know
That's simply not true.
Really?
Simply not true.
Do you know that? Have you spoken to David Davis? Does he know that
you... Yes, right. I met him before he met Guy Verhofstadt. He's very well aware of the procedure.
It would be pretty unbelievable, wouldn't it, Jean Lambert? I mean, who was telling you that?
Well, somebody who was actually in the meeting.
Somebody else who was at that meeting?
Yes, was in the meeting, not the one the night before,
right.
But the actual meeting with Verhofstadt.
Okay.
And it is this thing, I think, that, you know, the understanding of what is going on here, the timetabling of it, the magnitude of it, the fact that you're not going to have everything neatly wrapped up with a ribbon on it by 2019. You know, you're still going to have a transition period after that, I think is still not really there and clear in the negotiating
position
that we're hearing.
Isn't that the problem, though, Ashley Fox, with Theresa May's mantra that she's not going to give a running commentary? Because if you don't give some detail and if you don't flesh out some of the broad negotiating points, then Jean Lambert, quite rightly, and some of her other colleagues, and not that you're a colleague, Gerard Batten, in that sense, but on both sides of the political spectrum, will fill the gap for you.
And let's just wait until March.
Well, won't, is my point. That's what I'm saying to you.
But to be honest, the smoke and noise in the media really doesn't matter. What matters is the result at the end of these negotiations. And what we will see is in the run-up to the negotiations, people like Jean Lambert and others will create a lot of noise in the media. I'm concerned with getting a good result for Britain, and I'm confident that Theresa May will deliver
These whole negotiations are a myth. There is no way, after 2 years, the EU is going to present us with this mythical deal. They have no incentive to and no reason to, because they don't want us to leave. Mm. What we should do is repeal the European...
Or they might let us leave, but they might want to punish the UK for doing so.
I feel that what Mrs May wants to do is actually delay, and then at the end of it, present us with something like the Swiss or Norwegian option, where we still pay money, we still have to obey a large percentage of EU laws, and we still have open borders, in which case we might as well not have bothered at all. And there is a much simpler way to leave, which is just repeal the 1972 Act, and then all the EU directives would remain as Acts of Parliament, and we can amend and repeal those gradually over a period of time,
according
to our own
priorities. And Gerard Batten would think that, because Guy Verhofstadt, the chief negotiator for the EU, has spent his whole life campaigning for closer EU integration. So was it sensible to appoint somebody as hardline as that in terms of a federalist viewpoint, rightly or wrongly, to the role of chief negotiator?
Well, one of the key negotiators, of course, is also Michel Barnier of the Commission, and it will be national governments that are engaged in this through the Council. So I think, you know, that Verhofstadt is there to ensure, if you like, the interests of the European Union, and that is going to be his key role within it. But the idea that you can somehow simply pull the plug and create a whole sense of legal uncertainty in terms of even which jurisdiction applies for international for cables between the UK and mainland Europe, for what we're doing on Eurojust or any of these other things, I think is absolute fantasy land. There needs to be something here which is going to be absolutely concrete in terms of legal certainty, and that has to be part of the outcome. And we have to engage not only the European Parliament, but our national parliament within this. The idea that you can sideline elected bodies, I think, is outrageous.
But, Jean Lambert, is it acceptable, if there are going to be these negotiations, which clearly there are, that Manfred Weber, for example, calls the Foreign Secretary, Boris Johnson, unbelievably arrogant and say what they like about the British government? Will that help smooth the way?
Well, I think you can also argue whether Boris Johnson has been smoothing the way. That's right. What Ashley is saying in terms of a lot of the rhetoric around this is correct. That there will be sort of position taking, there will be sort of, sort of stretching things on either side. But in terms of the actual negotiation, there are a hell of a lot of nuts and bolts here that really need to be sorted through. This is not a quick and easy job, as some seem to think. There are things here which have enormous implications for business, for people's daily lives, and therefore that needs to be taken seriously.
And on the other side, as Jean Lambert was, I think, implying, Boris Johnson threatened sales on Prosecco if, you know, the Italians didn't sort of come on board. Is that acceptable?
I think Boris Johnson is a star. He does very well for
our
country.
So, you think that is fine?
No, he was illustrating the point that those countries in Europe will want to continue to trade with us, and I'm confident we will get a good deal.
Right. And do you think you will still have to apply, as pretty well all EU leaders have said, and also the Prime Minister of Malta, you would have to have some freedom of movement if you want to have full tariff-free access to the single market, and you would have to pay some contribution to the EU?
I think you need to distinguish between being a member of the single market,
I said full tariff-free access.
Well, Canada has just negotiated 98% tariff-free access. I think we can do better than that, and I think we can also retain control of our own borders.
This is a problem easily solved quickly, because the British government should now say to the European Union, we can negotiate with you ad infinitum forever, not necessarily reach an agreement. Your choice, do you want continued tariff-free trade with the UK, or do you want World Trade Organization rules? And let's give them a month to think about it, and they make the decision, because ultimately they're going to do that anyway.
Just finally, do you think that the Alliance for Direct Democracy in Europe, of which you are part, made up of the UKIP MEPs, will end up having to repay the €173,000 of allegedly misspent funds?
Well, I'm not a member of that, because I was very briefly a member of it. First of all, there is a double standard here, because I have been assured by the people in charge of this that all the money was spent in accordance with the rules, and that other groups under, you know, that have
been set
up... Have
you been misled?
I haven't been misled about anything. What I'm saying is that the EU Parliament acts as judge, jury and executioner in its own case, that other groups have spent the money in the same way on polling, for example, which was available to everybody, was
so
free to see.
So you are admitting it's been misspent then?
No, I didn't say that.
You said other groups have done the same
thing.
No, they've
spent money in the same way, which has not been ruled as against the rules.
Right.
They're doing the same thing.
But is that funding political activities?
In accordance with the rules, and political activity hasn't been funded. But there's a double standard here, because let me tell you something else. There is a big sex scandal brewing in the European Parliament. A number of assistants have gone to the Brussels police and made complaints about sex for jobs, and it's a big scandal that affects particularly the EPP
group. All right, well, that's...
The police have gone to the Parliament and said, can we investigate? And they are being impeded by the authorities.
Well, we will look into that, but I wanted to just
but
focus
on... it illustrates
on...
the double standard.
Well, double standards, as you have accused them of, but we were looking specifically at the misspent, allegedly misspent funds.
And it's not by UKIP. It's Fine. Nothing to do with UKIP.
Thank you. Jean Lambert, thank you very much. Now, let's talk about one of the most significant votes of the week in the European Parliament, and that was the decision by MEPs to back the suspension of EU membership talks with Turkey by a majority of 471 to 37. Pretty resounding. Politicians from right to left backed a symbolic resolution condemning the Turkish government's disproportionate repressive measures after a failed military coup in July. Well, our correspondent Damian Grammaticus has been speaking to Gianni Pittella, the leader of the Socialists and Democrats in the European Parliament, and asked him why he backed the move.
Erdogan has exaggerated after the coup de state. He put in jail thousands of people, journalists, lawyers, politicians, leaders of parties, everybody, but without motivation in front of this situation, we have decided to take initiative. And with other groups in the European Parliament, we reached a very large majority on this resolution.
But isn't it right that at this point in time, what the people on the other side of the debate say is that Europe needs Turkey. You need to keep talking. Now is not the time to stop dialogue.
Absolutely, but the dialogue is not stopped. We freeze the talks for accession, not the dialogue. We need Turkey, but we want a democratic Turkey. We want a country in which the citizens are free to discuss, are free to criticize, are free to oppose themselves to the government. But the view of Erdogan is a illiberal and anti-democratic view, and if he wants to introduce the death penalty, the relationship between EU and Turkey will finish. For always.
And what about refugees? Because Europe relies on Mr. Erdogan for his side of the deal to stop the refugees coming.
But one thing is not linked with other things. I don't believe that Erdogan will use this argument. And in any case, EU doesn't accept blackmail by Erdogan.
So Damian Grammaticus talking to Gianni Pittella. Ashley Fox, did you vote for the suspension of EU membership talks with Turkey?
No, my group abstained on this resolution. We think it's unhelpful because we regard Turkey as a strategic ally, important in NATO. We don't want to push them towards Mr. Putin. But at the same time, we are really concerned about what is happening in Turkey at the moment, the arrest of journalists, the arrest of opposition MPs. But the main opposition party in Turkey say this is unhelpful in their help to re-establish, in their, they're trying to re-establish democracy in Turkey. This move is unhelpful.
Do you not need to make a stand, though, against the things you have just listed? I mean, 471 to 37, I mean, I know you abstained, but most MEPs voted to suspend those talks.
We regard this megaphone diplomacy by the European Parliament as unhelpful. We want to carry on talking to the Turks, explain that they are important to us, but that we want them to come away from the autocratic system that they're developing.
Gerard Button, which way did you vote?
We abstained for a good reason, which is that this is non-legislative resolution. It has no effect. You called it symbolic.
It's not binding.
I would call it pointless. And, of course, it only temporarily freezes and everything will be all right in the future. Now, Turkey doesn't even fulfil the EU's own criteria for being a member. It certainly isn't a European country. Whenever there is a progress report on Turkish entry, which there is every year or so, we always vote against it, the UKIP MEPs. And, of course, the Conservative, Labour, Lib Dem, I believe the Greens, always vote for it.
Right.
And I'm surprised at Ashley's position, because the Conservative Party haven't decided they're leaving the European Union. Why would you bother to tell the EU whether that you know, Turkey should be a member at some point in the future?
You would like Turkey to be a member at some point in the future?
No, I wouldn't. And in fact, I think a majority of Conservative MEPs don't see that happening.
So why have these accessions? So why support accession talks at all?
It is a channel of communication to Turkey to encourage them along a democratic path.
Right. And the point of that is that Erdogan is extremely important. His country is sitting in an extremely important position. And he has already said that if this were to become binding, and I take your point that it's not at the moment, that he would open the borders and allow the migrants that he has taken in from the Middle East across into Europe.
Yes, but why are we leading Turkey up the garden path? They've been trying to join for 30 years. We have these continual progress reports that the Conservatives vote in favour of, including the Conservative
because
MEPs
it probably
tell me
suits,
they don't
it
want
probably
it.
Suits the Turkish politicians as much as
no
the other politicians.
There's no intention of letting them in anyway.
Is there no intention of anybody in the European Union
it's
to...
It's been going on for 30 years now, and they're less... They even less fulfil the criteria for membership now than they did 10, 15 years ago. They're going backwards in terms of human rights and democracy.
So, of course, it was always false to say during the referendum campaign that accession was just about to happen.
Well, you have to ask the Conservative, Labour and Lib Dems who always voted for Turkish
accession.
No, but
I'm asking you, it was incorrect, wasn't it, to always claim that Turkish accession and 75 million Turks were coming across the border into Europe, because as you have just said, it's never going to happen.
It was true that they are being asked to apply and that every time we have a progress report is voted in favour. So it was legitimate of us to say if they did join, then 75 million people would have the right to come here.
Is it a worry that Erdogan could use the stick of opening up the borders, even if this is not a binding vote against the European Union?
That is one of many worries. So is Turkey's move towards an autocratic system. Mm. It's very worrying that 100,000 people in the army and the civil service have been purged from their jobs since the coup in July. So I think we need to maintain a strategic dialogue with Turkey. And this megaphone diplomacy from the European Parliament is really very unhelpful. What we need is to establish a proper talks with Turkey about where their position is in relation to the European Union. I very much doubt that that is full membership. And I don't suppose that would ever get through the European Parliament.
All right, we'll leave it there. Now, what does the election of Donald Trump as US president mean for the Baltic states, ones like Latvia? It's a member of both the EU and NATO, but during his election campaign, Mr. Trump suggested that America might no longer defend NATO allies against military action from neighbouring Russia. In the latest of our Meet the Neighbours series, Adam's been to Latvia to find out more.
Friday, the 11th of November, and it's a big day in the Latvian capital, Riga.
11th November, it's a large places day.
How do you say it?
Large place diena.
Large place was a hero. He was a man with bear ears. That's what they say. That he killed a bear and he put those ears so he had more power.
Also known as Bear Slayer Day, it marks the moment in 1919 when Latvians saw off foreign fighters, ensuring the country's independence. But it's also their equivalent of Remembrance Day and a chance for the Ministry of Defence to talk about modern-day threats.
So this is a Scimitar tank from the Latvian Army, but here you'll also find troops from the US Army, from the 173rd Airborne. That's because in the last few months, NATO has been bolstering its presence in all three Baltic states to send a clear message to their next-door neighbour, Russia.
Meet the Defence Minister, a former Olympic weightlifter, now grappling with what he sees as a Russian build-up on his border.
We saw what's happening around our borders, and scale of exercises, snap exercises. We see strategic bombers, not just in close to our borders, but in fly close to UK and Portugal borders too. Of course, this is real rattling of sabers.
The kids love the weaponry. For the adults, Russia provokes a mixture of fear and resignation.
We are always between two big enemies, and Russia is one from them.
Donald Trump is elected, so he said great things about Russia.
But what about Russians in Latvia? 40% of the population is ethnically Russian or speaks the language. Miroslav runs a small political party that campaigns for them.
I think that the industry in the United States and maybe in Europe also is interest in aggravation of this tension, because it will allow to sold more and more military equipment. So the second reason, European democracy now is in some sort of deadlock. And one way out of the crisis is a war. It's a global war with Russia.
Lajplesis Day ends with thousands of candles laid by Riga Castle. It's to remember fallen soldiers, and it's really quite impressive. Latvia has been on the front line of history before. Now it's found itself there again.
Adam Fleming reporting. Gerard Batten, can you understand the fear of the Baltic states like Latvia since Donald Trump's been elected?
Well, I'm not a fan of Mr. Trump nor Mr. Putin. I think Donald Trump won because he wasn't Hillary Clinton. That's about the best you can say. I think that he made a big mistake by not backing NATO because Mr. Putin doesn't have an ideology. He's basically a gangster running against the state, but he is interested in winning prestige at home by perhaps winning back the territories
so
that
do
the
you understand,
old Soviet
So do you understand the fear?
Absolutely,
the
and I think Donald Trump needs to change his message and say that he's 100% behind NATO and that we're going to protect NATO countries under the clause which says one attacked, all attacked.
Right, and on that basis, again, do you understand why they are worried about the future policy and relationship between Putin and Trump?
Very much so, and it underlines the importance of NATO. And unlike Mr. Trump, and unlike Nigel Farage, I don't admire Mr. Putin. I think he's a menace.
Right. I mean, what about, though, the problem of Russians, ethnic Russians, or those who speak the language in a state like Latvia? Could you see it going the same way as the Ukraine?
Well, I think what happened
in
Latvia was the Russians who wanted to return to Russia when the Soviet Union broke up went back. And from what I understand is the Russian speakers who lived there were perfectly happy, by and large, to be part of Latvia. I'm not an expert on it, but that's my understanding at the moment. But of course, Mr. Putin doesn't need reality. It's a bit like Hitler and Czechoslovakia in 1938. He doesn't need reality in order to move into territories. He needs propaganda messages.
Right.
And he is dangerous. He is rational. That's one big thing that you can say in his favour. He's a criminal. He works on the basis of increasing his power and how much money he can steal. So he isn't going to make irrational decisions. But he might well decide that the West is weak enough in order to try and take back some of those territories formerly owned by the Soviet Union.
One of the potential solutions would be for increased spending by other NATO members. That, some people have said, would be enough to allay Donald Trump's reluctance, if you like, to come in on behalf of other states. Do you think that would work and do you think that should happen?
I think it's very important that all NATO members pay their fair share. And if Donald Trump made one valid point, it was that Europe is freeloading within the NATO alliance. So United Kingdom, Poland, Estonia, Greece, only four countries meet that 2% target, and all of them should.
Would you like to hear a commitment from Donald Trump that he would actually, or America would come in on behalf of another NATO member state in the event of any sort of aggression?
Absolutely.
For Russia?
It's very important that NATO stands by all its members and that the United States stands by its European allies. We don't want to detach European security from the security of the United States, but all European countries that are members of NATO have that responsibility to pay their fair share. We do that in Britain. All members should do so.
All right.
Something
thank
we
you
can
both
agree on 100%.
Oh, well, it's a good point to end the programme. Thank you both very much. That's it from all of us now. Bye-bye.